New year, new builds. Howdy, howdy guys, Ponchato here, and welcome to monthly builds for January of 2018. In these videos, I show you the parts I'd use for building gaming PCs at $500, $750, and $1,000 budgets. To keep up with new prices, new components, and component updates, I put up a new video every month, so be sure to subscribe to stay up to date. And I want to hear your input. What components would you pick for a budget PC build? Let me know in the comments, and it might be featured in an upcoming video. Hint, hint. First, let's look at some PC industry updates since the last monthly builds. AMD made quite a few announcements at CES regarding their roadmap for 2018. In short, the first Ryzen desktop APUs, which are basically Ryzen chips with integrated graphics, will be released on February 12th. These will be a welcome relief for budget builders who don't need or want a discrete graphics card, since currently the only AM4 CPUs with integrated graphics are from older generations. The next series of Ryzen processors is coming out in April, which is really exciting. The Ryzen 2000 series is being built on the 12 nanometer node, so in addition to higher clock speeds, they should also offer better performance per watt. Note, this isn't the Zen 2 architecture, but rather Zen Plus. Zen 2 isn't due out until 2019. Finally, the second generation of Ryzen Threadrippers is due out sometime in the second half of 2018. Those probably won't make a big appearance in budget builds, but for higher end and workstation users, that should be pretty exciting. In addition to all the roadmap updates, AMD also just lowered prices on many of the current Ryzen CPU lineup by as much as 30%. The Ryzen 3 processors are unaffected, but the Ryzen 5 and 7 series all drop by $15 to $30, which is great news for mid-range builders. In addition, the least expensive Threadripper, the 1900X, dropped $100 in price to $449. That's still far outside the reach of budget builders, but for content creators and high-end builds, that could be enough of a drop to make it worthwhile. Finally, Intel had a bit of fun with their Meltdown and Spectre vulnerabilities. Basically, these exploits affect every Intel product since the mid-90s, and Intel's received a lot of flack for how they've handled it. The good news is you, as a regular end user, should only have to run Windows Update to get the fixes. I included a link to a Reddit thread discussing the issue further, which is linked in the description below. Without further ado, let's get started with the $500 build. For the processor, I went with Intel's G4560 for $79. It's a 2-core, 4-thread processor running at 3.5 GHz, and after recent price cuts, has once again taken the budget crown. Plus, since it's such a cool processor, you won't have to worry about getting an aftermarket cooler. The stock fan is more than enough. Paired to that, I picked MSI's GTX 1050 Ti LP for $170. GPU stock and prices are being impacted pretty heavily by cryptocurrency mining, so our choices are limited. The good news is, since the 1050 Ti is only a 75-watt card, even a low-profile version like this won't run too hot or loud, and it's still more than strong enough for 1080p gaming. For the motherboard, I picked Gigabyte's GA-H110M-M.2 micro ATX board for $51. Because the G4560 can't be overclocked, there's really no reason to spend more on a higher-end chipset, and this one has all you'd need for a budget build. PCI Express by 16 slot, 2 slots for RAM, and an M.2 connection for an SSD once you decide to upgrade. For the memory, I went with one stick of Ballistix Sport LT RAM for $95. This one runs at 2666 MHz and comes in red, gray, or white. For the boot drive and storage, I went with Seagate's 1TB BarraCuda hard drive for $45. It's a bit cheaper than drives I picked in the past, which is necessary because of the increase in RAM prices. For the power supply, I went with EVGA's 400N1 for $35. Like the hard drive, I had to go with a cheaper option to keep this build under budget. The 400N1 comes with a 120mm fan, 6 and 6+2 pin PCIe power connectors, and a 2-year warranty. Just for reference, if you're worried about it not being powerful enough, my i5-7500 GTX 1060 build only draws about 190 watts under full load. 400 watts is enough for probably 99% of builds out there today. Finally, for the case, I picked Rosewill's FBM-01 for $25. It's a micro ATX tower case, pretty bare bones, and most importantly, cheap. When you're running on a tight budget like this, the case is really the last component you should be spending extra money on. It doesn't directly affect performance, and unless you're swapping out components every week, the benefits you'd get from a more user-friendly and more expensive case are limited. Altogether, this build comes out to exactly $500 right on budget. You could lower the cost by going with the GTX 1050 or RX 550 instead, but for the sake of future-proofing, the 1050 Ti is really the best choice in this case. Links to pick up these components are in the description below. Now for the $750 build. Like I've said in previous videos, $750 is what I'd consider the sweet spot in terms of price to performance. This will get you a strong 1080p gaming rig that'll last several years with good frame rates. For the CPU, I went with AMD's Ryzen 3 1200 for $110. This is one of my favorite CPUs because it's a true quad-core, overclockable, and, relatively speaking, dirt cheap. Plus, AMD has said they'll be supporting the AM4 socket for the next few years, so by the end of the 1200's usable life, you'll have a very strong list of upgrade options. For the GPU, I picked the GTX 1063GB from EVGA for $250. 1060s are getting hit by crypto mining, but the good news is they're also more than powerful enough for 1080p and 1440p gaming. A 1060 should last at least a few years, and if crypto mining ever dies down, then upgrade options will be very cheap. The motherboard I picked is ASRock's AB350M HDV for $65. To overclock the Ryzen 3 1200, you'll need a motherboard with at least the B350 chipset, and this one fits the bill without being very expensive. Like the other boards in this price range, it comes with the basics: two RAM slots, one PCIe by 16 slot, and a space for an M.2 SSD. The memory I went with is from Corsair, their Vengeance 2x4GB kit for $106. It runs at 2400MHz, and because the motherboard supports overclocking, you could potentially get it to 2666 or 2800MHz with relative ease. For the boot SSD, I picked ADATA's SU800 128GB SATA drive for $50. Having an SSD, even a SATA SSD, for your boot drive makes a huge difference in boot times and computer responsiveness. Because it's relatively small, though, you'll need a hard drive for bulk storage of games and media. For that, I went with Seagate's 1TB BarraCuda hard drive for $45. With the SSD for your Windows install and Seagate hard drive for bulk storage, you'll get the best of both worlds without eating up a ton of your budget. For the power supply, I picked the Corsair CX550M for $60. It's 80+ bronze rated, comes with a 5-year warranty, and my favorite part, it's semi-modular. This makes building and cable management significantly easier and helps with airflow inside your case. Speaking of the case, I picked Corsair's Carbide 200R mid-tower for $55. It supports full ATX motherboards, has a bottom-mounted power supply, and good ventilation on the front and top. Plus, I just like the way it looks. All told, these parts come out to $741, just under budget. If you're deciding between the $500 and $750 build, I'd recommend this one. It'll give you a lot more longevity in gaming, and because of the AM4 socket, a better foundation for future upgrades. Links to these components are in the description below. Last on the list is the $1,000 build. If you don't need to deal with a tight budget, this one will suit and serve you well. For the CPU, I went with the AMD Ryzen 5 1600 for $200. It's a 6-core 12-thread beast running at 3.2 GHz, and like the entire Ryzen lineup, it's overclockable. Plus, it comes with AMD's Wraith Spire cooler, which is quite capable for overclocking despite being the stock fan included with the processor. For the GPU, I picked ASUS's GTX 1060 6GB Dual for $300. The 1060 6GB is an upgrade from the 3GB with not only twice as much VRAM, but also more shaders. On top of that, the dual fan cooler from ASUS works quite well to keep the card cool and quiet. For the motherboard, I picked Gigabyte's AB350 Gaming for $100. It comes with all the bells and whistles of a higher-end board: two USB 3.1 Gen 2 ports, onboard LED lighting, and the basics like 4 RAM slots and a space for M.2 SSDs. For the memory, I picked Corsair's Vengeance LPX 8GB kit for $114. These sticks run at 3000MHz, which is great for Ryzen processors since they're so dependent on memory speed, and should offer some sizable overclocking headroom. I went with Corsair again for the boot SSD and picked their Force MP500 120GB for $80. This is an NVMe drive, so you'll see speeds several times faster than SATA SSDs, which should translate into much faster boot times and better system responsiveness. For bulk storage, I again went with Seagate's 1TB BarraCuda for $45. You could increase your budget a bit and get a 500GB SSD for boot and game storage, but that extra $50 or so will put you over the $1,000 budget. Power will come from Corsair's CX650M for $70. This power supply comes with an 80+ bronze rating, 5-year warranty, and semi-modular cables, which are a lifesaver. Plus, Corsair, in my experience, has a good track record for quiet fan operation, which is a nice bonus. Finally, to house all the components, I went with Deepcool's Earl Case RGB for $70. This is an ATX full tower case that comes with 120mm fans pre-installed in the front and rear, a 300mm RGB LED strip, and has extensive support for AIO liquid coolers. Oh, and a tempered glass side panel to show off your stuff. With everything together, these parts come out to $979. If I were building this, I'd probably swap out the SSD and hard drive for a single 500GB SSD for easier cable management and a cleaner build, but that's up to personal preference. If you want to pick up any or all of these parts, links are in the description below. And that's it for the first Monthly Builds episode of 2018. If you're building a PC for the first time, welcome to the community, and be sure to check out my build videos to see how it's done. If you're a veteran and just needed to catch up, I hope these recommendations helped you. If you want to get notified of new videos as soon as they're up, hit subscribe, then click the bell icon to enable notifications. So guys, if you like this video, hit the like button. If you want to see more, hit subscribe. And if you have any questions on these builds or the parts I chose, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for watching. I hope I helped, and I'll see you in the next video.